Welcome Jen Stamp. Perfect. She is from the Tetra Tech Center for the Ecological Sciences, and we're talking about the effects of extreme high flow events on macroinvertebrate communities in Vermont. Wow, that's a mouthful.
There's no way to adjust resolution, is there, at this point?
I'm going to try. See?
Yeah. I don't know, you're saying this way.
You can do it. You can do a present interview, but it shows both sides at the same time. I don't know if that would be something you would want to. Is this one? Let's do this. Return to me. Okay. You can do it. Fusion. There we go. I'm so sorry to both of you. I go to college, I swear. All right, without further ado. Thank you. Okay, thank you. Can everyone hear me okay? I tend to be soft-spoken, so just raise a hand if you need me to chime up here. So, my name's Jen Stamp. I work in for a consulting firm called Tetra Tech. I'm based out of a two-person outpost in Montpelier. For this talk today, I'd like to give a call out to some of the folks I'm working with. Aaron, is Aaron here? Because he was supposed to be. But by the way, I'm up here instead of these guys, which I'm still trying to figure out. Steve said something about being retired, but yeah. Anyway, these guys were involved with this from start to finish, and so they're the ones that collected the data. I just happened to help write it up into a manuscript, and anyway, I just want to give a shout out, Jim Kellogg, to the DEC folks who are here. We're all part of this. I also want to acknowledge Britta Bierwagen. She's the person at EPA who funds a lot of the work I do. I've been working with Britta since 2008 on looking at the effects of climate change on aquatic ecosystems. And so in particular, we're working with state and tribal biomonitoring programs to see how it's likely to affect their programs over time. And yeah, the typical disclaimer, this is me talking and I'm not representing any of those agencies. So this is a figure that's made its way into a number of presentations already today. It's an important one, though, so I don't mind showing it yet again. Extreme climate events are now the norm, as we've heard. This can take many forms, ranging in terms of water, from floods to droughts. Today I'm talking about extreme flow events, and so it relates to this precipitation figure you've seen a couple times, and in particular the Northeast has been hit in recent decades by an increase in the intensity and frequency of extreme rain events. And so these are going to have a big effect potentially on the aquatic ecosystems we work in. And I know it's preaching to the choir, this is a monitoring conference, but I can't emphasize enough the importance of monitoring data and how there's a lack of long-term time series data, especially in natural settings, that capture response and recovery to extreme events. Today, I happen to be working with a program like Vermont where they've started a Sentinel network years ago, and they happen to have data that captured Irene, before and after Irene, at 9 sites. So I'll be able to talk about that today. So you probably haven't seen Irene pictures in a while. This was back in 2011, but I'm sure some of these slides may look a bit familiar. I'll go through them quickly. The whole state was hit fairly hard in terms of precipitation amount, but some areas did get hit harder than others. Set all kinds of records for rainfall where there were USGS gauges. A number of them had record high flows. Some of the pictures that you probably saw back when it happened, these are from various locations in Vermont. Washed out roads had major impacts. And even the Vermont DEC lab in Waterbury, unfortunately, took a big hit too. And so my goals today in this presentation are to go through the data for 9 sites where they happened to capture before 2 years before the year of and 2 years after Irene. And we're going to be looking at the macroinvertebrates as well as substrate and periphyton data that they happen to collect. And then we're also taking a look too at what does that mean for the bioassessment scores and biomonitoring programs. So the 9 sites where they happen to have these data are reference sites. They're either minimally disturbed or at least disturbed. For example, in the Champlain Valley, that's Lewis Creek. That has more disturbance than the other sites, but it's the best example or the highest quality example we have from that area. So they range in size from small high gradient streams to larger, lower gradient, warmer streams. And Vermont has a classification, or they divide their streams into different stream types based on the macroinvertebrate communities, or they do so based on these physical parameters where they have the small high gradient or SHG category. Those are the smallest streams that tend to be the highest gradient. And then you work your way up to the warm water moderate gradient. They also have slow winders, but today our focus is on these 3 stream types. So I just figured I'd throw up a few photos. So the 4 small high gradient sites, some of you may be familiar with, some are in Green Mountain National Forest. We've got Bingo Brook on the upper left, Smith Ranch, which has a USGS gauge, and then Kidder. And medium high gradient, the next size up, East Branch North, Windhall, and the White. And then we have the warm water moderate gradient, Lewis, and the Nulhegan. So it's nice to have a diversity of sites to look at where we're not just focused on one specific stream type. So as mentioned earlier, the map on the left side here shows modeled precipitation data from the Weather Service. And you can see some sites in our 9 site data set got hit harder than others. It just happened that the ones in the small high gradient and moderate high gradient category got hit harder and had more amounts of precipitation than the 2 that are in the warm water category. There's the Nulhegan in the upper right there, and then Lewis Center on the western side of the state. So, and the difference was, on average, those small and medium-sized streams received about 6.5 inches of precipitation, and then the warm water moderate gradient about 3 to 4 inches. In terms of hydrologic data, we did pair 6 of the sites with gauges. 2 of them were located, the gauges were located right at the spot where they collected the bug data, but in other cases, we just decided, or we matched and felt, you know, for example, at the White River, that the flow was representative of what that site likely experienced, even if it wasn't spot on where we collected the data. This hydrograph that I stuck up is just one example for, this is the North River gauge, and we paired the East Branch of the North with that one. This is a time series plot where on the left, the y-axis is discharge, and then the x-axis has dates running from January 1st to December 31st. You can see Irene is the spike here. There's nothing quite like it in all of the previous years in the past. And so at this particular site at the north, that was in the gauge record went from 1940 to present. That was the highest annual peak flow at that site. The White River, which had been recording data since 1916, Irene was the second highest annual peak flow. And then another thing to note is just the atypical timing. As Jamie and others mentioned, typically the hydrograph shows a spring peak flow associated with snowmelt. This event was right at the end of August, so typically a time when you have lower base flows. So this is just a quick summary of how Vermont collects their bug data. They take kick samples from riffle habitats. They do it from 4 locations in the reach. Each kick is for about 30 seconds for a 2-minute total effort. And their index period where they go out and collect data runs from September 1st to August 5th or October 15th. So the year of Irene, it just happened to correspond with their index period in that it happened right at the end of August. And so their sampling dates range from 1 week to 1 month after Irene in 2011. So we decided to divvy up things into three events categories, we call them, where the pre-event data was from 2009 to 2010. The Irene data was 2011, and then post, we had 2 years afterwards, from 2012 to 2013. And then they did collect two sets from Ranch in the year of Irene. One was 11 days after, and one was 57 days after. And then they processed their bugs in the lab. They have a 300 count target, and they identify to the species level where possible. So they calculate a number of metrics for their bioassessment scoring, and these are the eight metrics. So density, richness, EPT, those are stoneflies, mayflies, caddisflies, typically indicators of high water quality, and other metrics like biotic index is an indicator of nutrient enrichment. These are the scoring schemes they use to rate their sites. So they go through each metric, and then they have thresholds for their different classes of water bodies, and then they go through and rate sites based on these thresholds. And so in addition, when they collect their bugs, they also do pebble counts. So they randomly pick up 100 pebbles and place them into a size category. And then also, they, as they're doing the pebble count, they assess periphyte and cover. And they do it for moss, macroalgae cover, and then microalgae thickness. And this isn't from one of their nice sites. This is from a different project. But yeah, it was a very active one. So in terms of analyses, it was a good data set, but it did have some limitations. But what we could do with it, we did ANOVAs to look at mean differences across those different groups, like the pre-Irene and post groups. And we also looked at differences across the site types and interpret with caution. Yes, it's a relatively small sample size, and sites weren't randomly selected. So there could be bias associated with those sites we picked. Scatter plots, if you're going to see a pattern, it's going to show up in these scatter plots. So we just looked at year-to-year variability, any temporal patterns over time in the plots. We grouped them by each site type, so all the small high gradients we threw into a plot, same with the different other categories. And we, for this one, didn't limit to 2009 to 2013. We threw all the data we had from 2000 to 2015 into the mix. And we also did an ordination to see if there were differences in taxonomic composition that we could see with the Irene samples breaking out from the others. So in terms of results, we looked across those eight different bug metrics, and density was the one that showed the significant difference during the year of Irene. In particular, it was noticeable at the small high gradient and medium high gradient, where those are the sites that also had the most intense precipitation, or the most amount. And so the small high gradient is this lower one, and those have lower gradient or lower densities naturally to begin with. But you can see there was quite a dip here. This is the Irene year, and this is pre and post. The medium high gradient are the ones that even had a bigger dip. The warm water moderate gradients up top, there was a decrease, but not quite as much at those sites. But once again, that likely had to do with the fact that those didn't get hit quite as hard. Interestingly, the total taxa richness, it didn't show a significant decrease during Irene. It did show a decrease, though. In particular, the medium high gradient sites showed a decrease, and they were slower to rebound as well the following years in terms of total taxa richness. And likely those reductions were driven in part by the reduced densities during those years. If you have fewer organisms in your sample, you're going to likely have fewer taxa. And the decrease in density but not richness suggests that those high flows weren't necessarily selective in picking certain types of groups of taxa or not. And I mean, it suggests to me that many taxa were probably able to find refugia, whether that meant burrowing down into the hyperaic zone, or and also some probably drifted down from upstream. These are good quality watersheds that likely have source populations up above. And these are just some of the scatter plots. And you can see this is the Irene here in the red kind of diamonds. In terms of bioassessment scores, this is just an example from one of their medium high gradient sites, the Windhall. And so this red cell is the year of Irene.
So all the others are green because they passed their thresholds for the other metrics. What happened at the Wind Hall was in this year of Irene, the density metric took a hit. The previous year was 2,518. This year it was 201. And then the following year it was 1,981. So it bounced back well the following year, but during that year of Irene, it went from its normal excellent to a fair. And in terms of the ordination, so just to orient you with this plot, it looks kind of fancy, but just to break it down simply, these dots all represent a sample from each site for each year from 2009 to 2013. I just played connect the dots. So for each site group, we connected the dots except for the Irene sample. We left that one out, and what we did was we drew a little cross in the center of each site group and drew an arrow to where the Irene sample is. One of the biggest take-homes from the ordination is Vermont did a good job with their classification or their stream types, because the strongest driver across here is their physical factors related to stream size. And basically, this is Lewis, which is on the end, the larger end and warm, low gradient side. That's one of their warm water gradient sites. And these are the small high gradient ones like Smith and Kidder. So they really break, those sites really group nicely based on stream type. And then you can see some of the sites did, you know, show a difference in composition during the Irene year. That, you know, for example, these are the Irene samples. And just to point out, that was based on presence-absence. We also looked at relative abundance, and it was fairly similar, where the strongest driver was those stream types. We also looked into the individual response patterns. You did see certain taxa bounce back fairly quickly, like the Betis tricaudatus. That's well adapted to disturbance. Okay, thank you. And then Dolopholoides is a caddisfly that didn't do quite as well. It decreased and was slow to bounce back at the moderate high gradient streams. Substrate and periphyton. So those are fairly variable. We just took a look at those data because they happened to be collecting them, and we were interested to see if there might be some signals, but they don't collect those data with the intent of picking up signals from events like these. We did see some patterns that suggested that some substrates did move around, but it seemed like any movement that happened, it was likely those substrates were replaced from up above. Periphyton, we did see a decrease in moss or periphyton cover, but none of it was statistically significant. And keep in mind, though, a lot of these are reference sites that don't have a lot of algal cover to begin with. And so that's it. I'm happy to take questions if you have time. So one question. Okay, go ahead.
I wondered if you took into consideration other high flow events that happened during those periods, for example, at Grange Brook.
Yeah.
Irene wasn't the highest peak flow during that period, like 2010 and 2011 had higher peak flows.
Absolutely, yeah. In the spring of that year, at a couple sites, the flows were actually higher. So we did look at it in the sense that at Ranch in particular, it seemed like that site gets hit with or had been hit with fairly high flows numerous times. And it seemed like it was reflected in the bug metrics. Like there were more mayflies, right, Steve? But you guys have taken a closer look at that site than I have. And I think in recent years that hasn't had as many high flows, and I think it's maybe bumped up to excellent again on the bioassessment scores. Or
right, I guess that frequency is just
the magnitude. But yeah, Ranch seemed like it was really flashy when you looked at those hydrographs, and so there's a lot going on. And in some cases, yeah, Irene was like that one hydrograph was so obvious the magnitude blew everything else away, but other sites it just kind of mixed in with other flows from different times. Okay, Keith, here.
It just seems like those results are pretty consistent with what we see below flood control dams, which artificially reduce the frequency of dominance by interview cats like those improvements. So that's interesting.
Perfect. Thank you, Jen. So the next.